I'm American and I watch Squid Game. It was very interesting. Doka, welcome to my YouTube channel where I talk about my personal life and basically, whatever I want. So, if you're inclined to subscribe, make sure that you like my vibe because we literally never know what I'm gonna upload next. I mean, I just uploaded me trying to do a K-pop dance. Has nothing to do with all of the reaction and commentary I've been doing lately. I'll share how I was introduced to Squid Game myself. I was bored. I watched all my shows, and I was tired of just watching Breaking Bad and Better Call Saul on repeats season after season. And Squid Game was one of those things that Netflix was just heavily advertising. Every time I opened up Netflix, it was instantly playing Squid Game. Every time I finished a season of something, it would play, watch Squid Game. Like, Netflix was like, B, if you don't watch this mo-effin' series, Squid Game. So I took the bite. I took the bait because it was colorful. That's a little embarrassing to say, but I don't think I would have watched if it wasn't so colorful. I just figured, worst case scenario, it'll keep my attention because it's colorful. The show ended up keeping my attention for various other reasons. I will say the subtitles are frustrating as it is with anything that is translated into English.
Hi everyone, I just watched Squid Game and I'm fluent in Korean and I had the English subtitles on and I noticed that you're missing so much from the English subtitles. Here, I tweeted about it earlier, pause to read. So I thought I would make a little video just to show you. Sorry, I'm a little busy today, so there's better examples, but these are just the ones that I found in like 10 minutes. So watch this, let me know if it's interesting. If you like it, I might make more. But here's the first example. I want to start with Minyo, by the way, which her name translates to beautiful girl, which I think is really interesting. Her dialogue constantly gets botched. Like every little thing that she says is fucked up. I think it's because she's like plays like a low class character and she's a gangster, so she cusses a lot and it gets very sterilized. And randomly, like even things that like don't even aren't even that bad, like she says like, "What are you looking at?" It's turned into "Go away," which might seem arbitrary, but like everything she says is not really aligning, and so you're missing a lot of this character and what she stands for. But here's the one part that I think is a huge miss. Here she is trying to pe convince people to play the game with her, right? Right here. The translation says, "Oh, I'm not a genius, but I can work it out." What she actually said was, "I am very smart. I just never got a chance to study." That is a huge trope in Korean media. The poor person that's smart and clever and just isn't wealthy. That's a huge part of her character. And almost everything she says is like being botched translation-wise, but you just missed, like the writers, all they want you to know about her is that. You know what I mean? It seems so small, but it's like the entire character's purpose of being in the fucking show. Here's one more thing that got me real fucking fucked up, and then maybe I'll do more of these if I have time, okay? So they missed a really small line there, but it's like literally the point of the whole episode. Gambu, 니꺼 내꺼 없이. What that translates into is there is no ownership between me and you. Not we share everything. That is a huge miss. That's like the entire point of this fucking episode. It's a very small sentence, but now it doesn't even make sense. Like what? It doesn't make sense. Like that is such a difference in ideology that the writer is trying to get across to you. Do you know what I mean? It's making me so angry. I have no idea why. I need to lay down. Anyway, let me know if you like this video. I can make more if I have some time, if it's interesting. There's so many more examples. It's like every other sentence is like messed up.
And the dub was horrible in English. Apparently the Germans, they have the most amazing dub actors. But in English, the dub was really irritating, almost distracting. So if that's a deal breaker for you, then just watch it subtitled. And I was really amazed to see how popular the show got. Even with the horrible dubbing, the show is like number one in the world. And that is so cool, so amazing. I think the reason for that is it's a really intriguing, interesting premise that people can kind of relate to. There's a lot of characters that you can relate to. It's very colorful. It's like mesmerizing to just look at.
I also want to note part of what makes it relatable is because it's working within the framework of capitalism. And throughout this show, there is this idea that you can be the one. You can make it above all of your peers. You can be different. You can win and create wealth for your family despite other people's failings or on the back of other people's failings. When in reality, most likely, you will just die in your attempt to achieve it.
So I think all of these things, plus Netflix is really pushing it, and Korean media is being consumed all over the world more and more than ever. I think, and there was nothing else to watch either. Like there was nothing to compete against Squid Game at the moment. You know, the new season of You still isn't out yet. I'm still waiting. I think all of that combined makes it a viral hit. And I'm glad it is because it's really interesting to talk about and think about.
I also want to note that now that we have TikTok, when something goes viral, like viral now today is super viral. So that definitely helped as well.
And I think if you're bored and you don't have anything else to watch and you want to start watching something just to have something to watch, at least that is a good enough reason for you to also check it out. Okay, let's hear what somebody else has to say.
For clarification, we're going to react to somebody who really likes the show and react to somebody who didn't like the show so much. So stay tuned, and I'll try to have timestamps in the description or something so you can skip to whatever part you want to, because I know how you be. I know how some of y'all are. Okay. Why is it so popular? We're going to talk
about it today while doing my makeup. Netflix K-drama thriller that recently, as of this video, is the most watched show in general on Netflix. The show is about a group of 456 players who have to compete in childhood games. It's basically a tournament, and the winner of all of it wins 45.6 billion won generates. Each player represents 1 billion won, so when someone dies in the show, it's added to a golden piggy bank. Yes, it's a literal piggy bank. So the biggest question I want to answer today is, why is it popular? And there's no concrete answer. Before going into the show, I already had my superstitions on it. I just thought, are people fetishizing us again? At first, I saw this through Twitter, because on the premiere day, it was trending on Twitter with over 1 million tweets already, so I said the K-pop community is going ham on something. The only tweets I saw were fan cams of Psybeok, which is easily the most popular character because she is conventionally the most attractive, even though in the show, no one's supposed to be attractive because they're all fighting for...
That's interesting. I don't think that woman is, at least by Western standards, conventionally attractive. By Western standards, she looks very exotic. So that's an interesting take that he has.
Their life. So from first glance, I thought, probably Asian fetishization, which I'm not going to rule that out. Obviously, in anything related to us, there's going to be a level of that, specifically Koreans in this case. But personally, I don't think that's the primary reason for its success. However,
it also wouldn't explain the success, because if it was just Asian fetishization, then all the other Asian shows,
all the other Asian shows coming out on Netflix would also be going viral. I think.
It's just, it's getting stronger with the popularization of K-pop. Korean music in general has led to K-drama. We're now seeing people talk about webtoons, also known as manhwa, which is the same way you say it in Chinese. Pop that off.
I had to find out what is that, webtoons. And it's like these little animated comics, you know, it's like a comic, but each panel is kind of animated and it's like drama. Interesting.
With the global success of Parasite and the awards it won, Squid Game.
I love Parasite. Oh my God. If you haven't seen the movie Parasite, just go watch it. Like, just watch it to at least say that you watched it. You know what I mean?
Game was kind of set up to be successful. That doesn't mean Squid Game wouldn't have been popular without the other influences, but it does help.
He's using a rare beauty brush, and I love rare beauty. Just saying.
Wait, and there's also other K-dramas that helped pave the way, you could say, like Train to Busan and Kingdom. None of this is a bad thing. I am always going to be happy to see Asians being represented globally and in media in general. You were happening during the peak of Asian hate crimes. Make it make sense. Do you like us or hate us? And right now we're seeing it with Korea and its entertainment industry. If we only...
No, I mean, the Black community has a lot of that where you'll see people mimicking stuff from Black culture. But then also there's police brutality, protests in the street, and people are arguing about how how horrible you are for protesting against police brutality that is disproportionately affecting Black men. Yeah, I mean, it's weird. It's weird. It's like when they hate you, they also want to be you or have a part of you. It's weird.
Indulge in the popular media of these cultures or the ones that the US decides to show, we start to have warped mindsets of what the culture is actually like. Sorry to burst your bubble, not every Korean person looks like a K-pop idol, and the reason why I'm only talking about these three countries in general is because no other ones exist, at least according to the US. Forget the other 100 Asian countries that are out there. Let's focus on the top three that make the most money. Netflix is aware of how lucrative the Korean entertainment industry.
I don't know what it's like to be that kind of ignorant person. Like, what he's saying is real. There are people who literally don't know anything about any other Asian countries other than whatever is popular at the moment. So Japan's popular. They know something about Japan, something about Korea, something about China, something about India. But ask them about Mongolia, ask them about Thailand. Ask them about Burma. They're just like, huh? What's a Burma?
Also known as Myanmar now.
Only makes it easier for it to hit number one because of how many people signed up for Netflix and other streaming platforms during COVID, which is still happening, by the way, so that's obviously a factor. We feel anxious when we see them go through these trials. Why do you think people tense up and get so passionate over football? They're feeling similar emotions that those players are going through. Maybe we're a little messed up by wanting to feel this way, but that's the whole point of horror movies, right? And I wouldn't call this horror. It's more thriller just because there's no jump scares. It's not meant to scare you. It just shows gruesome scenes. Like, they are not scared of showing death. And I appreciate that. And I also think that plays a part in why it's so successful, because we're just not used to seeing people show someone getting shot right in the face. Someone being stabbed. I'm not
gonna- that is a part of it. It's gory. It's gory. We're dealing with a little bit of bloodlust.
To show it on here, obviously, because we know what's going to happen with YouTube, but that just proves my point. We're not used to seeing it, so when it's happening in every scene, every 5 minutes, you kind of get used to it, but you're also wanting more, even if you hate looking at it. It's like a really weird addiction.
But the first time you see it, it's like that first scene, the one that you've probably, even if you haven't seen Squid Game, you probably have seen, there's this scene where they're playing Red Light, Green Light, and some big doll. Like, that scene was just shocking, and it's like, okay, it's this kind of show. Okay.
Going back
to... Let's go!
To capitalism. I think all these books that we read about teen dystopia, like Legend, yes, I'm a YA reader, every single one of these works shows the relationships between the rich and the poor. So we can relate to it because it's a reality. A lot of people are victims of capitalism, and Squid Game is not afraid to show the different aspects of that. So now that we're done with the context, let's get into the meat. The tofu, if you're vegan. I hate it when characters are so minor that even James Charizard doesn't care. Let me stop. That's like the third time I've called him out in a video. But it pisses me off when I see characters that serve no purpose. It's unnecessary for them to be in there.
I just got it.
Or they're so forgetful that I don't even remember their name. Squid Game does the exact opposite, for the most part. Obviously, there's always going to be minor characters here and there. Every single character is there for a different reason. Either they're in debt because they're a victim of stocks, business people taking advantage of them, being greedy, gambling too much. All of the reasons why someone could be in debt is basically put into each character. Abdul Ali is an immigrant Pakistani worker who is basically the only non-Korean person in the show. And
I felt like, you know how in like every movie in Thriller, there's just one black person. It's like a black guy, and he's like the most awesome, coolest, sweetest human, and then he sacrifices himself or he dies prematurely. I felt like that must be the Korean version of the token black guy. Nice touch.
In this show, he's the only minority because, you know, Koreans are the majority in Korea. So it's not only a rare presence for the show itself, but a rare presence for the Korean film industry in general, because to my knowledge, that's not a big representation that we see. Whether or not he is the best representation is up for debate, because I've heard his English dub is a little stereotypical and it doesn't make sense on why he has an Indian accent when he can speak Korean perfectly fine. But
that they made that choice, but I actually didn't listen to him without the dub. Hold on. Does he sound? Does he not have an accent without the dub? Okay, here is how he sounds like in the English dub.
Why won't you answer my calls?
You called, huh?
And now you're here. What's up? Is something wrong?
Sir, stop. Pay what you owe me now.
Yeah. Don't you remember? I told you, I've got no money. Business isn't going so well.
Look at what working here did to my body, sir. I couldn't afford the hospital either. Now look here, I gotta go. Give me the wages you owe.
Damn it, go and ask the rest of my employees if they got their paychecks yet. I can't pay anyone until I get the cat.
Let's hear it in Korean.
Oh, Ali. 왜 전화 안 받아요? 어, 전화했어? 몰랐네. 예. 무슨 일 있어?
사장님, 밀린 월급 주세요.
He still has an accent.
내가 그건 몇 번 말하냐. 지금 돈이 없어. 너도 알다시피 회사 사정.
저 손가락 치료 잘 못 받았어요. 병원비 제대로 못 받았어요. 나 이제 고향 갈 거예요. 제발 좀 주세요.
He still has. No. He still has that accent. He still has that accent in Korean. So I don't know. I mean, listen. I don't know. People have accents sometimes.
Cyborg, which is honestly probably fan favorite of the show. She used to live in North Korea but managed to escape with her younger brother. But
she's a fan favorite because she's like, it's kind of like if you watch Better Call Saul, how Kimmy's a fan favorite. People just like a character who is smart, has a story that you sympathize with. It's beautiful. You know,
but her mother is still in North Korea, so she needs to get her out. However, that costs a lot of money. Also, she got fucked over by some business dude. This is all. The plot itself isn't the most unique thing. Shh, don't you dare comment yet. I never said that was a bad thing.
Of course.
Nothing in my opinion can be. In my opinion, the main driving force of the plot is the character development and the relationships we see. Jung obviously is the winner, never eliminated. But when he said he would go into the games, he swore on his mother's life. And when he returned home, his mother died. That's messed up, man. Also wins 4.56 million won in the gambling game, and in the end he wins 45.6 billion. I don't know what it is with the 456. It's always his number, and I don't know the significance behind it because I don't know what 456 means in Korea. Like, is there a secret meaning behind it? All I know is that the number 4 is hated in Asia in general. But if you do have a theory on what the meaning is behind that number, I'd love to know your thoughts.
Hey, I want to know the thoughts. Okay, so I found somebody in his comment section. They said, apparently, the angel number 456 means if you work harder in yourself, then you will live the life that you deserve. Besides, your hard work will add value to your life. I don't know if that's what they were going for, but that's a pretty awesome detail. Interesting.
Queer baiting in the show. I'm using quotes because I got opinions on this. They show a relationship, and I mean that as platonically, between Jung and Cybyok. There's some tension because Cybyok slams her against the wall because she's angry. She's like, why did you give up the game? And some people are saying, why didn't they make a canon? Why did they bait us with this? Why didn't they just make him kiss? I think this is.
No, y'all can't be doing that. Y'all can't, just because you saw, I didn't, just because you saw something that kind of tantalized you, that doesn't make it queer baiting.
Another symptom of us saying everything has to be labeled, because I've talked about this before. I don't feel the need to label everything because that seems counterproductive to what the queer community is about. There is no rush to label yourself. The point is that it's a spectrum, yet everything is categorized, so it doesn't make sense. Also, does that mean nothing can be queer coded? What is the difference between queer coding and queer?
I didn't even think it was queer coded. And queer baiting is more specific to the way you advertise something. Queer baiting is this idea that you are trying to entice people to watch something or be a part of something because you're almost promising that there's going to be a queer relationship, and then you find out, just kidding, there's nothing queer here. And I don't think that's queer baiting. And if it is queer anything, it would be queer coded. But I personally, I didn't feel like that moment between those chicks where I didn't feel it was queer. I don't know. Somebody send me a video. I'm sure somebody's made like some kind of fan music video that shows all the little looks and everything. Honey, somebody send that to me, please, because I didn't see it. I didn't sense it.
Also negates the fact that two females can just be friends. Did we forget about that?
I'm back, bitches.
I'm here because I found out some new things since filming it. Apparently, the director did want them to explore the relationship between two women because originally Jung was casted as a boy, or meant to be a boy, and then he changed it. So yes, gay rights. But also, I want to emphasize the point that people are more upset that they just didn't kiss. And my point is, why do they have to for you to feel like it's queer? That's all. It does not make sense for any of those characters to kiss.
It doesn't make sense in that situation. First of all, I didn't feel that they were attracted to each other. Girl relationship can still be friendship. That's a relationship. But I didn't feel that there was an attraction. And if there was, it kind of doesn't make sense. I don't know. I'm not in the mood. I don't know. I mean, I know there's some movies where the characters are about to die, so they want to do it real quick, but I don't know. That's just not the place, not the time. There's a time limit. There's dudes with masks watching where it's hot, sweating. I don't know. I said hot, sweating. Somebody in the comments is going to be like, that's the perfect situation. Somebody's going to be like, dudes with masks watching? Time limit? Hot, sweaty? What more could you ask for?
Because that ending pissed me off. Jiyoung, just get on the plane. Help your daughter. You know who the real victim is? The daughter. Okay,
baby,
not Gabby.
I'm saying, when he was like, oh, I'm coming, baby. And then he's like, I need to stop the games. I'm like, sir, how about you just, can you at least go see your daughter? I mean, I don't know what the hell you think you're going to do right now, but can you at least go see your daughter so she doesn't grow up thinking you a trifling ass, good for nothing, worthless scrub? Bro, no, I was like, you're wrong for that one. And I felt so sorry. I'm like, this girl finna be traumatized. This girl, his little baby girl finna be traumatized as hell.
And the daughter. Let me know what y'all thought about Squid Game and what I should review next, because
well,
there's a
I
lot of shows coming
this,
out lately.
Because then you'll know what I thought about it. Us to watch
whether
together.
It's music or through movies and TV, the Western world.
Let's not go so fast.
In the U.S. has really opened itself up to Korean media and Korean culture. In movies and TV, it's introducing stories and themes that are either absent from traditional American media, or if they are familiar, they're shown through a unique lens and often strays from traditional Hollywood formulas. This brings me to Squid Game. The newest Netflix special out of South Korea has become extremely popular a week after its release. It currently sits at 100% on Rotten Tomatoes and is already projected to be Netflix's biggest show ever. So, on a day off, I binge-watched the entire series. And... eh? I mean, first off, it's not bad. Far from it. There are much worse ways to spend your time. I'm more disgusted in myself for spending 93 minutes to watch Slenderman in theaters than I am for investing 9 hours into Squid Game. But 100%? Netflix top 5? Biggest show ever? I'm so conflicted between what I watched and the reception that it's getting that I'm compelled to make this video. Not to invalidate anybody for liking it, but just to open a discussion.
Hold on. Yeah, let's discuss. First of all, yeah, I don't know why the critics are giving it 100%. Okay, I don't know. But the audience gave it 87%. And I think that 87%, is valid. I think that 80% is realistic and appropriate. And yes, right now, when there's nothing else to watch, a show that's at 87% can be number one. And a show that has an international audience and is going viral during a time that we have TikTok, which makes things super viral, yes, it can be number one in the world. I mean, come on. The formula is right there.
This is my argument for why I think Squid Game is overrated. I'd like to open my argument by exploring what I enjoyed about the show first, because there are a few aspects of which I really enjoyed. First, the performances from all the main cast are great. There's never a point where I feel like their delivery or their emotions are unbelievable, and they do a great
job. Unless you're watching the English dub.
Job. Everyone except for the VIPs, but we'll get to that later.
Oh my god, I don't know why. It's like, why can't anybody who speaks English in the show act?
The cinematography and soundtrack are really solid. Their use of lighting and color are bold and purposeful. I love the MC Escher stairwell and the mysterious humming before the game sets a foreboding tone as they embark on a new challenge. My favorite episodes of the show were actually the first two episodes. Oftentimes in movies and TV, it can be hard to place a character in a desperate enough situation where the measures they take to advance the plot don't feel forced. And Squid Game doesn't falter in this aspect at all. Within the first few minutes, we learn that Gi-yun lives and steals from his mom, gambles and gets his winnings stolen, is hundreds of millions of won in debt to a loan shark who threatened to take his kidney and eye. Not only did he lose custody of his daughter, but her new family is far more successful and they are also moving to the US in a year. The show really takes its time to set up not only the main character, but the supporting characters as well. These characters aren't only in debt. There's several other factors layered on top of that to make them so desperate that they realize that the better of the two options presented to them in the first episode. Is the latter. In a story in which the characters are voluntarily committing themselves to this experience, this aspect of the story is critical and they knocked it out of the park. For the first two episodes, it felt like at every turn my expectations were subverted. This began with the contestants asking the masked men in the beginning questions that I was asking myself in my head. This is a small detail, but I'm so used to characters lacking common sense in strange situations that it was refreshing to see realistic reactions from the contestants. This also extends to after the first game, when people held a vote, and the vote actually passed. I had thought for sure they would be trapped in there for the duration of the series, but no, they actually held a vote, and everyone who survived the first game gets to leave and go home. That is awesome. I absolutely love that. Not only does it lend itself to my previous point about emphasizing these characters' desperation, but it is an incredibly refreshing way to build their side characters. Typically, these scenes would be shown before the games when we as an audience don't have a connection to them yet because we don't know them. Or they would be done as flashbacks, allowing us to be introduced to them, but ruining the flow of the narrative by spending time looking at the past rather than advancing the plot. The best example of subverting my expectations came during the first round. It was obvious that the punishment for the games was going to be death, but the sequence of people realizing and completely forgoing the rules of the game is something that I just wasn't expecting to see. The trampling and shoving.
And that's so natural. Like the way they reacted, even though like logically it's like, do not move. But it's like, you just watch somebody get their brains blown. Like, you're freaking out.
Though it's a horrifying scene, took a reveal that was already obvious and was still able to create shock and awe. Unfortunately, the slow burn pacing that lent itself to the first two episodes would ultimately also work against it. Does anybody else think that this season could have been 5 or 6 episodes? Or think that it's essentially one really long episode of Black Mirror? I feel like I'm spending all of this time in between the games, waiting for the next game to start.
Same.
And it's strange because it's not like there are pointless scenes thrown in to extend the runtime that you can just cut out, but rather the present scenes go on for so much longer than they need to. The best example I could find of this comes at the finale of the fifth game when...
Oh, baby.
Well, I'll just show you.
This scene, I was like, what is going on here? I was like, okay. I was like, oh, okay. And then like kept going and I'm like, okay. What's happening? I was so confused. I was just like, huh? was just so... Yeah, you just sit and watch it, like, okay.
Do we really need 54 unbroken seconds of slow-mo for three?
But what's funny is there's people... But when I'm watching it, I'm like, I bet the director just thought that was the coolest thing. I'm like, they thought this was the coolest thing. And then if you go on TikTok, you'll see people like, oh, this scene is so cool. But I'm with this guy. That was awkward to me. That was really awkward. I was
identical,
like, okay.
Cuts on the characters' cheeks. This scene alone represents so much of what I think holds Squid Game back that it's a perfect point to transition into my next topic. The plot armor that these characters wear in this show was handcrafted by Brock and Sindri, and then later refined by Eitri and the power of Nidavellir. And I know that Sindri and Eitri are the same person, but let's just roll with it. I don't need all of my shows to be Game of Thrones. I understand that plot armor is essential to telling a narrative.
And then I had to put two and two together about what is plot armor? But you get it, right? You're understanding what's plot armor.
But I feel like Squid Game just shoves it in our face. I mean, every single game, Gi-Yun is finishing with less than a second on the clock. And to me...
That's why I'm like at the end, like, baby, you barely are alive. You pass every mother effing game, you pass with like a millisecond to spare. Well, what make you think you finna take them down by yourself?
It just comes across as incredibly cliche and predictable. I'd honestly rather Gi-Yun be one of the first characters to finish a challenge and leave the last second finishes to a side character whose fate we're truly unsure of. Also, when Min-Yo is the last one out before going into marbles, she isn't killed and instead just gets to skip the game entirely because... sure? The scene with the glass is just another incident of them shoving this plot.
I think it's just kind of lending itself to unpredictability. I thought that was weird too. I was like, that doesn't make sense. But their whole thing is they want everything to be fair. So, they, like, as monstrous as they seem, as heartless as the game runners seem, the game master does come out and he explains how the whole point here is here, everybody's equal, everybody's given a fair chance. Everyone is given a fair shot. So, if there's an odd number of contestants and every contestant needs a partner, obviously the last person did not get a fair shot, so it makes sense.
Plot armor in our face. Multiple panes of glass explode in front of all of their faces, and all we see them get are the tiniest little paper cuts. I know that it's revealed that Sebyeok is severely more hurt than the others, but couldn't they have at least gotten cut in
I was like, damn, she's skinny. I'm like, how are these all these K models and K, because that chick's a model. I'm like, how are y'all so skinny? Damn, where are your organs? Where are your organs sit?
Different places? It comes across as borderline parody with how absurd it is. That also brings me to another problem that I have with this scene. Why would the VIPs, who, by the way, are the worst performances in the show, I mean,
so bad.
Painfully bad.
What's that thing? Looks like a bridge of some sort.
I like the looks of it.
Why would they do this?
It's so weird.
Realistically, they should all be dead after this.
And then one of them had like a Texas, like a really, like a really bad Texas accent. And I was like, oh, Lord help them. Lord help them.
Explosion, and then boom, all of their finalists are dead. There was never a point in the other game where the contestants who won were in danger after completing the objective. Also, what is this game? Do children in Korea gather differently treated panes of glass and play this game on the playground?
No, dude. Like, why? Is he being facetious? It's like a stepping game, but they're heightening the stakes by making it glass. Just like in Tug of War. You don't play Tug of War, like, 50 feet in the air and the losing team falls to their death. That's not how you play Tug of War. They heighten the stakes of childhood games here. So that's what they're doing. Like, I don't know. Like, this guy, like, so far, this dude is, like, running away from the logic that the show already presented. The show is being consistent in its logic.
It's called stepping stones. So is it literally just referencing jumping on stepping stones?
You know, like, when you play red light, green light, you don't get popoed when... you move on red light, you know what I mean? Like,
this game seems so out of place from every other game, which could literally be taken out and played on a playground.
You can if you play the glass stepping stone game on the playground, you're playing regular stepping stones.
Another similar moment which left me confused out of my mind was during the second game. When guards are intensively looking over contestants' shoulders for the slightest crack in your honeycomb, Mino is not only blatantly cheating, but is somehow able to pass the letter to a partner so that he can also cheat, all without the guards noticing.
I was like, I'm gonna let that little loophole slide.
Seriously, we're really doing that? All of this plot armor leads what was an unpredictable show to an incredibly, almost painfully predictable show. The third game is a team-up game, immediately ruling out any threat of death for the characters on the main character's team. And as soon as it's revealed that the only other team of relevancy, Deoxu's team, isn't competing against Team Plot Armor, it's pretty obvious that they aren't in any real danger either, immediately eliminating any sort of suspense in the outcome of this game. This leads into the fourth game in which characters begin to pair up, and it's fairly easy to assume that the reason for this pairing up is because one person from each pair is gonna die. Deoxu pairs with one of his henchmen, Sebyeok pairs with the girl she just met two episodes.
Well, I don't know, I didn't guess that. I didn't know that one of them that you choose is going to pass. So I don't know. Maybe you're just better at guessing than I am. But definitely once you realize there's a lot of plot armor, then you know, oh, this person's going to be alive. No, I'm not going to worry too much. But you are still intrigued to know, like, how are you going to do this? Or maybe it's one of you going to... Like, maybe not all of you have the plot armor, you know what I mean?
...ago, and Gi-Yun pairs with the old man. Thankfully, the way they carry out these deaths is arguably the most powerful moment in the whole show, with betrayals of trust and acts of love.
Yeah.
However, since we know that they are coming before the game even begins, and we can say...
No, we didn't know. We didn't know it was coming before the game begins. Nope. Maybe you did. So share how you knew. You're not explaining how you knew.
...safely determine who out of each group will survive thanks to the god-tier plot armor, it doesn't help that this game is by far...
No, because that dude is paired with the old man and you kind of feel like the old man is going to survive, but you also feel like, well, the protagonist is also going to survive, so you don't know which one... No, I just got to disagree with him on this. It wasn't clearly obvious to me. Not with each pair. No.
...the longest one yet. In screen time... The first game took 10 minutes, the second 17, and the third 25. The marbles game takes up 40 minutes, almost an entire episode, with nothing but dialogue. And there are great character building-
Wait, is he trying to say that like that's a bad thing? Hold up.
...moments to take from it, but does it genuinely warrant 40 minutes of runtime to set up-
No, my dude. The whole freaking episode is about relationship building, trust, betrayal, all this stuff, and you're gonna ask, did it need 40 minutes? Yes. There's a lot of characters that we're going through.
Deaths that were guaranteed before they even stepped foot in the room?
No, you keep saying that. But not to all of us. No, it wasn't guaranteed. And also, that's part of what makes it poignant, is that you... Because you're tied to the surviving character, and the surviving character is now tying itself to this character, and the moment is touching. It's not like a fake, oh, that was supposed to be touching. You really felt touched. And what makes it even more painful to us as the audience is, you know, this character's got to go. Like, while you're watching, you know, this character's got to go. So it's like hurts. Like, that's the point. It's called having emotions, my guy.
At this point in the show, the only thing keeping me interested is the storyline of the cop trying to search for his brother, while also-
You just don't have, Tin Man, we got a Tin
covering
Man
covering the secrets
here.
And motives behind this organization. This B-plot, you feel, is really building to a big reveal at the end of the season.
This
However,
dude is so cringy, that, this white man.
This B-plot, you feel, is really building-
They showed his bare bottom. I was like, I did not...
...to a big reveal at the end of the season.
I wanted to see that.
However, this is where we reach the final problem that I had with Squid Game.
Okay.
The ending.
Yeah, because first of all the issues that you brought up in the middle of your video, I don't think are bad enough to warrant people not liking the show. And I just completely, wholeheartedly disagree with one of your points, so...
The cop story ends when the front man, who's been running the games this whole time, turns out to be his brother, a former winner of the games, and then kills him. While yes, this does answer the questions of who is the front man and where is the cop's brother, It's not nearly as satisfying as it should be because it just feels forced.
Well, I also wonder if the brother didn't actually die. I wonder if he actually survived that fall and he'll come back in season two. I don't know.
Like, of course the front man is his brother. Does it make sense? No, not really. But who cares? It's a twist.
It doesn't make sense because we don't know the backstory yet. That's why we're supposed to wait till season two, because we're expecting that we'll get this backstory in season two. I'm not understanding what this guy is having issues with. I'm not getting him.
Oh, but how about the twist that they did set up? The twist of the old man being the host and the creator of these games, choosing to compete in the games because he wanted to live like a kid again before dying from a tumor inside of his brain. Mm-hmm. I see a lot of people pointing towards his performances in the games as some kind of untouchable god who can't lose. And there's plenty of plot holes in these clues, but the biggest one I can point out is during Tug of War. I've seen multiple people talk about how their team won because of Il-Nam's unbeatable strategy. Did we all just forget that the strategy ended up failing, and without the quick thinking of Sang-woo, everyone including the old man would be dead? Look, I know I'm beginning to sound nitpicky, and the truth is, I can forgive everything I've mentioned so far. My biggest issue lies with Il-Nam's motivation. The reason behind coercing all of these desperate people into life-threatening children's games is because he is rich and bored. You're kidding, right? In order to put into perspective how dumb this is,
he thinks this is a dumb motivation. Has he never heard of this thing called the dark web? You know, it wasn't too long ago. Hold on, let me hear his explanation.
Let me compare Il-Nam's motivation to the motivation of the people behind the hotel in the movie Old. In Old, guests with untreatable health conditions are coerced to a beach where they are unable to leave, and their cells age so...
By the way, I wish he gave a spoiler alert for this movie. I haven't seen Old yet, and now it's spoiled. Thank you.
...rapidly that their entire lifetime is reduced down to 24 hours. The motivation behind this is because a research group is running drug trials on these guests, gathering multiple lifetimes worth of data over only days of research, in hopes to find cures and treat the greater population. The old Thanos rap. Not only is this twist fantastically set up throughout the whole movie so it makes sense once it's revealed, I'm looking at you, frontman, but the motivation, though extreme, comes from a realistic place of wanting to help everybody, even if it means sacrifice.
Now, first of all, how is wanting to help everybody realistic to you? Like, how is that realistic to you? That's not realistic to me. Like, if you told me the motivation behind a company doing something is to help everyone, I wouldn't believe you. That's not realistic to me. What's realistic to me is y'all gonna create a medication that nobody else has so you will dominate the market and make more money. That is a realistic motivation to me. Wanting to help everybody, that's not realistic to me. See, this guy just lives on a different plane. He just lives somewhere else, this guy. That's why I'm not getting him.
Imagine if at the end of Old, it's revealed that the owner of the hotel got so wealthy from his business that he got bored and decided to torture people on a beach for his own enjoyment and wager on who would last the longest. That is literally what Squid Game's
I would believe that. It wasn't too long ago that YouTube, the website that we're on now, were allowing videos of homeless people fighting over $20 bills. I wish I was kidding. Homeless people fighting over $20 bills, and people would put bets on which homeless guy they think is going to win. Like, people are sick. People are sick, people are twisted, and a lot of people in power and a lot of people who have money are sick and twisted. They are. And there is such a thing as the dark web. There is such a thing as, what is that kind of, you know, that kind of prawn where, like, you're torturing, but they like to see it be real. What's that one guy? There's this one place, I forget what it's called. It's like a haunted house. I forget what it's called right now, but it's like a haunted house where it's actually torture. Like, you fill out a form of all the things that you're afraid of, and then you'll go there and they'll have it. So if you're like, oh, I'm deathly afraid of spiders, they will bind you and put your head in a container full of spiders. They will put your body in a freezer and close it for 5 minutes at a time, let you out, splash with water, put you back in. You know, like, they will bring a chainsaw that doesn't have the parts on it, the part that cuts, so, you know, they don't catch a felony, and they'll let it rub on you, so you're like, you're feeling something rough on you, you're hearing the sound, it's dark. This is a real place. Like, there was a month where everybody was talking about it on YouTube, and the people work there because they love hearing the screams. Like, my guy, you don't understand that people are sick and twisted in this world. This guy is so, no, I'm sorry, you're out of touch to me. You're so out of touch that what is more realistic to you is the idea of a corporation doing something for the sake of helping people. No. You live in a different planet.
Reveal is, and it's just bad.
You live in a
Maybe there was a deeper planet. Commentary about the relationship between the higher class and the lower class, the old man and the VIPs being so wealthy that their only form of entertainment is watching people from the lower class try and succeed. But whatever it was trying to say, Parasite did it better. Let me finish this off by saying Squid Game is not a bad show. It's actually a good show. But through slow pacing and lackluster writing, disappoints in what I would expect from what people are calling a top 5 production on Netflix. Although this video goes against everything I'm about to say,
I think it is. I mean, even everything you're putting into consideration, think about everything that Netflix has produced. Not a show that was made elsewhere and it came on to Netflix. A show that was funded by Netflix. It's a Netflix show. Like, well, what? Think about it. Think about your top 5. Netflix. You know what I'm saying? No, I think that this is a top show. I think everything that you put everything into consideration here. I think they did a great job with the set design, with the most of the camera work. I mean, no, I just gotta disagree with you.
I am of the belief of just let people enjoy things. I don't want to make you agree with me. Rather, I want the diehard fans of Squid Game, who have probably already disliked this video and left by now, to tell me why I'm wrong. And maybe
well,
season 2.
I told you. We'll see if you watch my video. And I'm not even a diehard fan. I'm just somebody who can recognize something that was enjoyable for me and the reasons why it was enjoyable. And I can recognize why the issues that you have don't actually make sense. Like, I have issues, you know. You didn't even mention how horrible the dubbing is, which, you know, maybe it's not their fault, but the stuff that this guy mentions doesn't make sense to me. Some of it makes sense. You saw me agree with him on some things, but there's some, but his big, the issues that he has a lot of problem with, it just, I'm like, no, your logic isn't enough logic for me.
2 comes out, I'll make a video on how blind I was to its brilliance. Probably not, but.
Well, yeah. I just randomly found you. So did I subscribe to you? I like commentary, so I probably did. No, I didn't. I'll subscribe. Okay. So there we go. We heard from a fan of a Squid Game. We heard from a hater. And now it's up to you. I mean, there's a lot of spoilers here. So if you haven't seen the movie, and I'm the kind of person, too, that sometimes I don't mind a spoiler. A spoiler might be the thing that then I can't speak. Psychedelic water is trash, by the way, and it makes it so I can't speak. Sometimes a spoiler is what makes me want to see a show. But let me know your thoughts in the comments section below. If you like this video, like it. If you think other people should see it, like it. And then that means that Frederick Chen guy and this tough specialist might be more likely to see my video and see that I reacted to them, and they might have something to say, which would be intriguing. Until next time. Is it raining hard? I love when it's raining hard. Until next time, much love, much luck. Peace out.